This warm evening. thank you very much, all of you, for coming out and for being so enthusiastic. This is clearly a topic that has captured some sort of zeitgeist at the moment, so I'm absolutely delighted with the response this evening. My name is Sophie Gaston. I'm the editor of Demos Quarterly. I also look after our international projects. I would like to start this evening by thanking our brilliant partners at the British Council who we've joined with on this special edition. We are both organizations that are very curious about the world and we champion connectivity, so it was a natural fit for this topic. Just to explain a little bit about the genesis of this issue, there were two points, starting points really, but they're both interlinked. The first is that this year, 2017, marks the 20th anniversary of the Cool Britannia era, a phenomenon that actually began from a Demos paper way back when. So we were very interested to revisit that and look at what had changed, what hadn't changed, and where we'd all come to after this this big dynamic, exciting time in the late 90s. The obvious second point is also Britain's decision to leave the European Union last year. The two come together perfectly because they ask us, who are we and how do we want to be seen in the world and who do we want to be? So with this issue, we have brought together 20 really brilliant writers and thinkers from Britain and beyond. We wanted them to interrogate these issues, to explore questions of our identity and our culture and our place in the world. So some of these writers have been kind enough to join us this evening.
So the format for this evening, we will have two separate panel discussions to give everyone a chance to have more questions and to drill hopefully into the issues in a little bit more depth. I've just come from across the square from Parliament, where they are sitting as we speak, actually, the MPs, and I can tell you there is a palpable sense of exhaustion. I think everyone is looking forward to the summer recess, and to the extent that think tank pamphlets are ever beach reading. I can confirm that this one very much fits the bill. It's both stimulating, original, interesting, those bits of it that I've read, which is practically all of it, certainly those bits that pertain to our guests this evening, that's just as much of courtesy as much as anything else. But it does feel as if we have, in this country, been in a state of sort of febrile campaigning frenzy, more or less, since the Scottish referendum, which was 2014, and it hasn't really stopped since then, and we really haven't had a chance to just take stock and understand quite the extent, quite the degree of the volatility of the times in which we live, and the country is changing before our eyes, and for that reason alone, it's a great opportunity to just ponder and consider not just how much has changed since that original 1997 Cool Britannia moment, but obviously all the things that have happened just in the last few months and years to throw this all up. And yeah, and so straight on to our two guests for the first panel who are going to enlighten us, I hope, on this subject. I'm confident they will. Christine Patterson and Simon Heffer, both eminent writers, broadcasters, journalists. The format you're familiar with, I'm sure they will say a couple of things about their contributions to the pamphlet and then very quickly we'll go on to questions. I'm going to just kick things off with you, Christine, if that's okay, just by asking you one question, which I hope will provoke you into unpacking your thesis for us, which is, your contribution to the pamphlet stresses very much the creative genius, the creative spark that is Britain, Britishness, and that this is will be our salvation, this is what will get us through these very difficult or complex times that we live in. But on reading that, it occurred to me pretty much any country, certainly any country in Europe, could articulate exactly the same thought. So if it were France, they would say, we have the genius of Molière. If it was Russia, they'd say, we have the genius of Pushkin, Germany, Goethe, etc. So just explain a little bit more, what is it that's uniquely British about the phenomenon that you're describing and how it's going to help us?
Well, is this switched on? You take that one.
If those countries articulated that case, they would be wrong, because the UK has a particularly rich culture. I mean, it is known, I mean, we have the head of British Council here, whose job it is to sing the praises of British culture, and luckily that's a relatively easy thing to do, because I don't think anybody in the world would deny that it is extraordinarily rich. But I should probably start by saying that when I was asked to contribute to this essay collection and was informed that the theme would be a kind of optimistic post-Brexit vision, I thought, seriously? Seriously? I'm practically suicidal. You expect me to be optimistic about this thing? I have to say, you know, on record, that I think it's the greatest, most catastrophic act of self-harm that our nation has ever inflicted on itself. I think this is an absolute disaster. So, you know, we, however, you know, I'm a journalist. If I get asked to write something and there's a check in the post, I will think about the question that I've been issued, and I did. And we are in this situation, and Phil Collins actually wrote a very good but very depressing column last week about the fact that given we are in this situation, we are going to have to find a way to navigate our way through this nightmare that we have created in a way that does as little damage as possible. But it will do damage, let's be clear about that. So I think we are in a kind of post-war situation, and after the Second World War, we did a rather good job. We created an NHS, which is the envy of the world, and I think this week has been rated in certain ways one of the best healthcare systems in the world, which, given the funding challenges it faces, is pretty extraordinary. We created a welfare state. Sure, it's straining under the seams, and it will sure as hell be straining even more under the seams when we're taking out, say, a 60 billion divorce bill and, say, 20, 30 billion in our GDP lost every year, never mind changes in investment, drops in sterling, etc., etc. But let's be cheerful for a moment, shall we? And forget about the economy and say that one emphasises what is clearly a fact, that the Brits are very, very, very good at culture. We are world class at culture. We are in a league of our own when it comes to culture. Now, we thought we were in a league of our own when it came to everything else. We created an empire, some good things came out of that empire, lots of very bad things came out of that empire, and ultimately we realised our hubris in creating that empire and disentangled ourselves from at least most of it. The one thing I think we have every right to be very, very proud of is our ability to create great literature, great art, great theatre, great film. I do think we have a legacy going back an extraordinarily long time. You could go to the Anglo-Saxon poets, you could start where you like, Chaucer, Milton, Shakespeare. It's a running theme. Sure, the French can talk about Molière and Racine and Rimbaud and Verlaine, and then what? You know, the barrel runs a bit dry, frankly. Germany, Goethe, Heine, yes, sure, but we're not talking the same breadth as we are with the UK. We are very good at this stuff. We're going to have to be bloody good at this stuff because we're not going to have very much else to draw on, frankly. So I suppose I'd say, yeah, let's go with our strengths, because we managed to demolish quite a few of our strengths. We better salvage some of the strengths we've got left.
Okay, I'm not going to take the opportunity to have an argument with you right now about 20th century French and German culture, but before we get to Simon, I've just a question that springs from that. I'm getting the impression you were one of the 48% that voted against.
Oh, I can't imagine.
Just a lucky guess, I suppose. And given that what you've spoken very eloquently about the potency and the originality of British culture, when you look at the 52% who voted leave, there are all sorts of motives that were involved in that. But can you not take a step back and see that too was a passionate and authentic expression of kind of British exceptionalism? That is worth celebrating and cherishing.
Listen, I don't think anything in life is cut and dried, and I thought very seriously before the campaign launched about which side I would be on. So I accept that I sound extremely categorical now about something that was a complex decision to make. I absolutely accept that, for example, too much immigration was thrust on people too quickly, and it had a very big effect on some communities, and on the whole, the middle classes are protected from those challenges, and I do think that we have been far too cavalier about that. So I absolutely accept that people voted many of them from the heart, and I have no doubt that Simon, for example, was one of the people for whom sovereignty is a hugely important issue. And I do think, you know, of course I don't write off those people, of course I don't. But I suppose ultimately I would say that in the cost-benefit analysis, lovely ideals like sovereignty, when they are weighed against the economic benefits of staying in a deeply flawed institution, I would say, let's err on the side of caution, and we didn't.
Okay, I'm sure now audience will have some thoughts on that in a moment. But Simon, in your piece, one of the lines that struck me was a moment where you compare Brexit almost to a, or quite literally actually, to a sort of post-colonial liberation movement, which is a very powerful, even you know, quite pungent metaphor in many ways. And one thought that occurred to me, I'm going to put you in a position where it's March the 30th, 2019, and you're waking up in the morning and it's your first day of freedom out of the European Union. You poured yourself your first glass of sparkling English wine to celebrate. And there's some very good Sussex sparkling wines, I guess.
Just send me a bottle.
What? And my question is, what is the thing that you do that morning as an expression of your identity? Not when you pick up the phone and negotiate a new trade deal with Australia. I mean, what is the thing that you do as an expression of your identity that was not permitted to you before, when Britain was a member of the European Union?
Well, I can't do anything that day, and this is going to be a general election, Raphael. When there is next a general election, I know that the people I'm voting for, whoever I vote for, can discharge his or her democratic functions without having to refer them to a higher power, somebody else outside. And Christine is absolutely correct. I believe passionately in sovereignty. I'm a Democrat. I accept the outcome of the 1867 Reform Act, and I am delighted that everybody in this country, men and women over the age of 18, have a vote. And you hinted yourself at the start of your remarks that we've had an excess almost of democracy in the last 3 years. Well, a very good job too. The more that people participate, the more that people vote, the more they get used to taking big decisions, and the better it is for our country. And I have very few connections, believe it or not, with an elite. One of my rare connections with the elite is I have the great honour to be a member of the high table of my college at Cambridge. And I went up there shortly after the referendum last year and found the permanent resident fellows of my college in a state of shock that the people of Britain had defied the Dons of Cambridge and had voted to leave the European Union. And one of them said to me, because I'd spoken to him before it, and I let him know that I thought that it was going to be very narrow, but that Brexit would win. He said, why did none of us realize this? I said, well, did you ever speak to your bedmaker? Did you ever speak to the woman who gets on her bike from the village outside Cambridge at 5 o'clock in the morning and rides into the college and does all the menial jobs that you take for granted? Did you ask her what she felt about her relations to the European Union? Because if you had, you might have a clearer idea that there were people outside your very small, highly educated, highly sophisticated elite who did not take the view that you took of our relationship with the European Union. And I'm afraid that that was true. I'm afraid that there's a lot of people, many of them lifelong Labour voters, and I met them during the campaign last year, who were utterly disenchanted with the European Union and felt that they had no connection with it. And I can't speak for Jeremy Corbyn, I've never even met Jeremy Corbyn. But Tony Benn told me many years ago, and I admire Tony Benn enormously, that Corbyn was one of his people, he was a Bennite. And I wasn't remotely surprised by Jeremy Corbyn's silence during the referendum campaign and his ready willingness now to embrace Brexit. Because as an old Bennite, that's what he always wanted. That's why Tony Benn sat in 1975 during the first referendum campaign on platforms of Enoch Powell and Peter Shaw and talked about the importance of leaving the European Union, as it was not then called, in order to reclaim national sovereignty. So I can't do anything on the first morning, Raphael. I had a conversation just over a year ago before the referendum with a friend of mine, you may be familiar with him, Petroc Trelawney, who presents the breakfast programme on Radio 3, does it extremely well. And he came up to me at a party and said, you know, I've got to present the breakfast programme the morning after the referendum. What do I do? And he said, I've got a plan for what he expected would be the result, that we would stay in. He was going to play the Ode to Joy and go through Ravel and Respighi and various other people. I had to tell him that Villa-Lobos wasn't actually a Spanish composer, we're going to that now. But he said, what do I do if the result goes the other way? And I said, well, you've got 2 hours. Just play Jerusalem 50 times, which sadly he didn't do. It's rather a good tune. I want to talk about culture though, Raphael, if I may, more than this. Because I actually went to the Cool Britannia party. I'm a sufficiently old fart. That 20 years ago, Tony Blair asked me and my wife to the party. It was a really good party. I met some very jolly people there. I treasure a photograph of Tony Blair talking to Noel Gallagher, who I believe is a popular entertainer in the law, with me and the editor of the Times in the background having a conversation. I write about culture as well for my newspaper, as well as politics. And I felt very much that we were in an era in Britain where culture was very strong, where film was strong, where we have terrific classical composers. I'm ignorant about popular music, but I believe that's doing quite well as well. And of course, we have a tremendous artistic culture, which is, in the plastic arts, which is probably one of the best in the world. But I think back, as I often do, to the 1940s, to a time of real crisis, when we had an existential fight for the first half of the decade against one of the most evil regimes ever put on the face of the earth. And we were in severe danger of losing our freedom, losing our democracy for all times. And there grew up during the Second World War what Vaughan Williams memorably called an outbreak of national consciousness, that we suddenly became really interested in culture. It was when Dame Maya Hess was giving piano recitals in the National Gallery every day, and office workers, people from Whitehall, servicemen on leave, servicewomen on leave, would go into the National Gallery, look at the pictures, listen to Dame Maya playing the piano. It was a golden age in the English cinema. Most of the really great films you can think of that have ever been made in this country were made in the 1940s. Powell and Pressburger, Ealing, Gainsborough Studios. I mean, really fantastic films that harness that sense of, first of all, that sense that we were all in it together, that we had to fight this evil common enemy together, and articulated that through propaganda of various degrees of subtlety. We had great writers, Graham Greene, Evelyn Waugh, who were at the peak of their powers. We had great composers, Britton, Vaughan Williams, William Walton. We had great artists such as Francis Bacon starting his career. It was a time when we were up against it, when we felt that our very existence was threatened, that really produced a concentration of great culture, of great art, whether written, plastic art, film, music. And later on, once buildings started again, architecture, to demonstrate that we had the seeds of genius still in and among our people. And when I look today, when I read the book review pages at weekends, when I go to concerts, when I go to the opera, when I go into galleries, we have the most incredible, and I hate to use this ghastly left-wing word, vibrant culture. We have this brilliantly vibrant culture in this country.
Do you divide all adjectives into left and right?
No, with that one I definitely call left wing on. I've never heard a conservative use it with a straight face.
Can I respond to something on that?
No, please say something.
Just on what then do you make of the fact that I can't remember the statistic, not because I've had half a glass of wine, but because I can't remember the statistic, right. Which is that I think the Creative Industry Federation have said that something like 98 or 99% of their members who are artists, writers of various kinds, were pro-EU. And I have pretty much yet to meet a writer or artist who is pleased about the Brexit vote.
Well, I'm a writer and you met me, Christina, which I'm very glad about. And I am pleased about it. I'm sure that they are. I mean, I've had stuff sent to me in recent days from the Society of Professional Musicians, who are very worried about bringing in talent from around Europe to perform in Britain in a couple of years' time. And I very much hope that Europe will accept what I... I'm not a fan of Mrs. May, please don't get me wrong, but Mrs. May, I think, has made the correct offer to Europeans who are here, say anyone who is here, who's migrated here legally, should have citizenship. And of course, he or she should have citizenship. Of course they should. And I hope that, those problems about the movement of artists in Europe will be settled as they were before 1973. There was a tremendous number of performers, writers, everybody else who came to this country before you were in the EU, and I didn't see why it should change afterwards. I mean, the question of the reclamation of sovereignty does not mean that you close your borders to people. Far from it. I've never written a word against immigration. I'm entirely in favour of immigration. I would just like to be consulted occasionally about who comes here. That I hope will be one of the outcomes of Brexit. So yes, I'm well aware that people in the creative arts are very much against it, but we've only just begun these negotiations. When it's sorted out, as it will be, because the democratic will of the British people will be executed, when it is sorted out and people see that the creative arts continue very much as they are now, probably identical to the way that they are now, the people are still writing books, still making films, still performing. The people are still coming in, like Daniel Barenboim at the prom last night, coming in with the German orchestra and conducting Elgar in the Albert Hall. But they see that is still happening. Maybe things will calm down a little. But I'm well aware that the word went round the creative professions that it was a bad thing. I'm yet to see the evidence that it's going to be a bad thing. And I think we have a fantastic culture in this country at the moment, in every sense. And that there, in the same way, if you like, that there was this, as what Vormalin's called, this upsurge of national consciousness during the Second World War when our existence was under threat. But now that we are embarking on a new life where we're engaging not just with Europe, but with the whole world. And let's not forget that. I've never thought that we're going to be isolationists because of this vote. We're going to go out there and engage with the whole world again, and not just another 27 countries in Europe, who I hope will still engage with us in a different way. Then we have a great future.
Okay.
And I just feel, as I've said in my piece, I feel more optimistic about our country now for that reason than I've felt for many years.
Okay, let's take some contributions from the floor. I want to add just in that one sort of point of technical difference, that 48% of people didn't vote for the Blitz, so there were cultural divisions there that had to be healed, which make that analogy complicated, but we can maybe come back to that. Not a single hand has gone up, so that's a bit more like it. Right, do we have a roving microphone? We do. Or no, you're going to steal my microphone, aren't you? I can tell. You're going to steal someone else's microphone. Okay, you're going to steal Simon's microphone, and he's going to share with Christina. Let's have this lady on the aisle just here.
Who says I'll share a microphone with
the rest of you? And we'll take a couple, so, and then another hand went here as well, and then let's have someone further back, but you shoot.
Sorry, I wanted to make a couple of comments before, but the last phrase you said really, I loved it. Were we really under threat now? When you mentioned the 40s and Britain was under threat, so everybody was rich, where was the threat now?
Don't answer that now.
I won't answer.
It's very difficult.
We're very tight on time, so let's just try and get
the point in. In a war recently, where was the threat to...
Well, I will tell you, but I'm not allowed to tell you now.
Yes, I'm interested in my apologies to the chair. So there's a lady here, and then there's going to be a gentleman who... Yes, you, sir. Keep your hand up, please. Thank you. Go, shoot.
My question's a bit more specific. It's we're talking about creativity and artists, and of course, if you're... a great British creator, whether you're Stella McCartney doing fashion or one of our, top film directors, then that's fine because, of course, you're still going to go on creating. But you're also talking in particular about jobs, right? Why did people give the government a shooing because they felt that, immigration had come in for a variety of reasons and had taken jobs? A huge number of jobs are created, if you like, in the strata of creativity that we have in this country for people who are runners on sets or are, in apprenticeships at the BBC or whatever they're doing. Yeah. And a lot of the films or TV programmes that are made now by huge, studios coming in are because of the tax breaks and the regime we have that is European-based. It used to be UK, it is now European, and for that you can do what we like to call double dipping and all sorts of stuff, but you can basically make the tax system work for us. That will now be gone. And we have been told that there will be a reduction in the creative economy as a whole. So it's all very well talking about highfalutin creativity at the top level, but what about people that just show up for a job?
Okay, great. And then the gentleman who I asked to keep his hand up, but he wisely took a break from that and has now restored his hand back up.
When Jerry Gunster, the advocacy consultant employed by Leave EU, commissioned research into the British public's view of the EU, the only thing that mattered, and they put it thusly, they said, behind every reply was immigration. Do you know, when you look at funny presentations of polls, you see these extraordinary proxy words. Proxy words like sovereignty or control. They are all about immigration. There is a very small group of a London intelligentsia, particularly a small group of kind of a right-wing London intelligentsia, who have another view about the way the EU works. But if you go back to 2012, in an Ipsos Mori poll, 1% of British people were agitated about the EU. They had other things to think about. In other words, what happened, and we know what happened, was that the EU became a proxy for the vast number of voters for immigration. And that is why the result went as it did. And I am always fascinated to hear from people who take an elitist view, which they very often justify, saying how lovely it is to have the will of the people. It's coming, however, from people who don't normally like the will of the people. At one little bit, they don't like the taste of the people, the will of the people, or anything about the people.
Okay, Isabel, thank you. Kristen, why don't you respond to that first, or amend to that as you can, and then as briefly as we can on the panel, let's answer that so we can get some more responses.
Okay, thank you, Peter. I was going to make exactly the same point. And it is, I'm afraid, Simon, you say you don't have, I can't remember what was the word you used, establishment links, but there is this tiny coterie of Tories for whom this abstract issue of sovereignty was important, but all the polling evidence shows that immigration was the issue. And there was the earthquake just after, I think it was the next day after the referendum, when Daniel Hannan said, oh, but I think we'll keep freedom of movement, and he was one of the key campaigners. And everyone was going, whoa, I don't think so. That's what the British people have apparently just voted against. So I absolutely agree with you, Peter, that unequivocally, the issue was immigration. The question is, if people want fewer immigrants, how you salvage an economy, whether you, in the light of that, since all the evidence shows that EU immigration has actually done enormous good to our economy, and what you do about the immigration which we ostensibly control, which is going up and up and up. And in terms of the arts issue, absolutely. I mean, it's all very well, you know, for novelists sitting at home in their garrets or rented bedsits or whatever, it probably won't make all that much difference. Any other kind of creative industry, it makes an enormous difference, because so much of the legislation, economy, etc., is bound up with the EU. And what we have in every single area, including in, what's the atomic agency called?
Euratom.
I've had cancer twice. I've had radiotherapy. I'm sure as hell hoping I don't get it again. Because every single thing you think of is massively bound up in legislation, disentangling, sovereignty. I honestly don't believe that most people gave a flying fig about any of this stuff. They wanted to cut immigration. And we don't even know if we will cut immigration, but we do know we'll be cutting pretty much everything else.
Simon, I imagine you've got a response to that. But if you can keep it punchy, we'll get some more.
I'll be brief. The gentleman at the back, if you can find anything I've ever written in 31 years as a columnist in Fleet Street against the will of the people and against democracy, I'd be very glad to see it. I have happily accepted even Gordon Brown becoming Prime Minister in 2007, even though he wasn't elected, because I felt that was a continuation of the will of the people in 2005. So I'm never sniffy about that. I don't want to live in a dictatorship. I want to live in a country where people can vote for who who rules them. The lady here, we already have sovereignty over tax. We can have whatever, I don't know anything about tax breaks in the film and television industries, but if they exist at the moment, they don't exist because of the EU, they exist because of us. We're not part of a common tax policy in the EU on anything. And once we have sovereignty, it'll be up to the people down the road there whether they decide to give tax breaks to the film industry or not. I have family working in that industry. I very much hope therefore that they do. Also, I know from my family connections with this business that so many programmes that are made only get funded because they're being sold to come to other Anglophone countries such as America, Australia, New Zealand. And that's where the joint funding comes in for so many programmes these days, and that will be unaffected by Brexit. There was another lady who asked me about threat. Madam, you're quite right to correct me on that, because actually I don't feel that I'm threatened by this in any way at all. But every time, and I went to a lunch today that was full of Remainers, who the minute that it was realised I was a Brexiteer started to throw bread rolls at me. And one of them wanted to throw a plate that was talked out of it. They're the ones who feel the threat. I didn't feel the threat at all. But there are many people whose lives seem irrevocably to have changed. I feel very bad about that since the 23rd of June last year, because they feel that we are heading for some sort of apocalypse. I don't think that we are. However, if that is the feeling among the creative community, as the lady there suggested that it is, then all I'm saying was, if there is that sense of threat, then maybe it will produce very fine art, as it did in the 1940s. I point out that although Raphael's correct to say that 48% of people didn't vote for the Blitz, or whatever it was, it's not about how you get to the state of feeling threatened. The fact is that many people in this country feel threatened by what happened last year. I'd also point out that we continue to produce absolutely brilliant art in the period of austerity that lasted from 1945 to the end of the 1940s into the 1950s. Again, because we were a country that was getting used to the post-war settlement and then to a new consensus, to a very radical government where things were changing dramatically. And I think that in cultural terms, periods of change, whether one agrees with those changes or not, are very stimulating for the creative communities.
Can I just check in my position as I'm trying to ask this question as neutrally as I can, just from to clarify if I understand your position though. On this point about sovereignty, do you accept that there is a spectrum that includes absolute 100% total sovereignty over everything that happens in a country without a cession of anything to any supranational authority, so you kind of where you're sort of the North Korea option, and then at the other end there is a kind of total dilution of sovereignty where nationhood and the institutions of the state are completely subordinate to international institutions, and that somewhere on that spectrum, yes, you accept that the EU is too far for the UK, but you're okay with, say, NATO and WTO and other, you know, tribunals for courts for trade institutions, that sort of thing. So, given that you have that spectrum, would you, say, accept EFTA or the EEA? Where do you decide that you've got enough sovereignty, given that you can't have perfect sovereignty?
Well, I quite agree with you. Thank you for the neutrality where you asked that question. You can't have perfect sovereignty. I'm just rather glad that come March 2019, we'll have a lot more sovereignty than we have at the moment. Parliament needs to make decisions about international groupings such as the UN, such as NATO, such as EFTA, such as WTO, that it goes into. I was personally unhappy that we were unable to make our own trade deals. I was very unhappy about the common agricultural policy. I was very unhappy about the common fisheries policy. These are things that will change after 2019. My only reservations about immigration were that we were not, I sound much in favour of immigration, but I didn't like the idea that we had to take people from the European Union in an indiscriminate way. When one reads newspaper stories, as many voters in the election did, about pickpockets and rapists who come from former Eastern European countries, they, as many of them said to me, we have enough of these people of our own without importing them. And I used to get letters from immigration officers as a newspaper columnist saying, I know we are admitting people to this country who have no warrants outstanding against them, but who come from Eastern European countries and who have had long-term lives of very serious and unpleasant crime. and I wish we could stop them, and we couldn't. And it's very, it's simple cases like, we're not talking about stopping masses of French people. I think there are 400,000 French people living in London, and thank God they are, paying huge amounts of taxes here and making an enormous contribution to our country. No one's complaining about that. Or people who come and work as nurses in NHS hospitals. No one's complaining about that.
But they won't be able to anymore, Simon. So we will be. I mean, we are going to have a big gap in the NHS.
But you say anyway, I mean, the point that Nigel Farage, two dirty words in this group made up, but he continued to make, was that we should be able to choose who comes here. And we would be an insane country if we said to nurses and doctors from the European Union, you can't come here because you're European. I hope that there'll be loads of nurses and doctors coming here after 2019.
Just a moment. Let's go back out to the room, actually. Generally, just because he's standing up, why don't you give him the microphone, and then come this way, standing remotely.
Thank you very much. Quick question, given that the impact of what we're doing in terms of Brexit is going to be long lasting, why on earth did we not include 16-year-olds, 17-year-olds, and 18-year-olds in the vote?
Right, more hands. There was a sort of cascade of them down here. So, yes, gentleman here.
Thank you for the panel. It's a very good debate. My home constituency is Bootle, which, before the last general election, was the third safest Labour seat in the entire country. So if anyone needs Labour opinions, I'm fortunate to say I'm in a position to provide them. And the people of Bootle, it is one of the most deprived areas in the country. And I must disagree with the notion that immigration was the overriding factor. Bootle, on a constituency level, was a Leave constituency. And the majority reason why a lot of people in Bootle voted Leave because they saw a large red bus with 350 million a week to the NHS right on the side. These are people who from cradle to grave depend on the welfare state, and they saw protecting the NHS as the most important factor for their voting Leave.
Okay, thank you. And then let's go, this gentleman here, who's got to stand up with your fingers. Yes, you.
You said that we'd be mad to turn away nurses and doctors from the EU. What about the EU doctors and nurses that I know who now no longer feel welcome? And now feel that, despite the fact that they've lived here for a long time, they were educated here and they work for us, that the people don't want them here, so why shouldn't they go home?
Okay, thank you.
This is why I'm so keen, and I'm glad she's done it already, but Theresa May has said the people who've come here and have migrated legally from the European Union should be given citizenship. Of course they should. And I wish the EU would accept that and let that happen and get that settled early on. I can't think of anybody who has said to people like that they're not welcome. And not just highly professional people like doctors and nurses. I know there are a lot of manual workers in this country who come from Europe. And as far as I'm concerned, it would be outrageous for us to send anybody out of this country who's migrated here legally. And that should be made absolutely clear. And I'm very sorry that the European Union, having had this offer made to them, by Theresa May, has said, oh no, it's not good enough. I don't know what more they want.
Can I just interrupt you there to say that in this context, you sound a bit like your Cambridge Dons, because there are very, very many people who can tell you very clearly, categorically, that they have been on the receiving end of very aggressive verbal, written, other threats.
I find that utterly deplorable.
Well, it's not a case of if, Simon, because all the statistics show
that... Because I haven't experienced it.
It's
utterly deplorable.
Well, it has happened on a mass scale. So-called hate crime in this country and racist incidents. I can't remember what the statistic was, but they quadrupled or something in a short period after, and they have remained much higher. So many, many people who have, as the guy in the audience said, given big chunks of their lives to this country and of their service and sweat and toil, have now been absolutely made to feel unwelcome in this country and held in unnecessary uncertainty by our government for the last year, and made an offer which was couched as generous, which was deemed not generous, and is now couched fair, not generous, and is still not deemed fair by the EU. So I think we have to accept that even if you want sovereignty, freedom, and all these lovely feelings, the result so far of the referendum has been huge unhappiness, misery, distrust, hatred, racist attacks, which we didn't even have in this country on that scale before. And how we are going to heal that, I don't know.
I know I'm sure you're itching to answer that, but I think, in fairness to the audience, can you limit yourself to why 16-year-olds allowed to vote was their future, and where's my 350 million weekly NHS charm?
Well, in reverse
that
order.
Directed at you. No.
I mean, I did campaign during the election, during the referendum. I did not campaign for Vote Leave, and I thought that the Vote Leave stuff about 350 million a week was outrageous, and I wrote that in my columns at the time. As we know, it was a £350 million a week in total that would be saved if we didn't make a net contribution. And the idea that it would be spent on my health service was not for Vote Leave to decide, it was for the government of the day to decide. So I utterly deplore that.
Gross and, figures on that figure.
Or whatever it was. It was dishonest, and they shouldn't have made it. And certainly when I was advocating a vote to leave, that figure, bogus as it was, indeed no other figure, entered my calculations. I wrote purely about sovereignty, and my conscience, therefore, is clear. The point about 16 to 17-year-olds, well, you know, we've had a decision in this country, which was taken, I think, in 1967, to lower the voting age from 21 to 18. If we want to have a debate about the voting age, it shouldn't just be in referendums such as that. It should be for everything. And we need to have a mature debate about whether 16-year-olds, I mean, why stop there? Why not 14-year-olds? I know that when my children were 13 or 14, they were perfectly capable of exercising a vote. They didn't pay any taxes, of course, any more than 16-year-olds do. But they would have made a very rational decision about whom to vote for.
You can pay an NI at 16.
Well, yes, but most 16-year-olds are in full-time education.
And you can get married at 16.
And you can, yeah, but most 16-year-olds are in full-time education and don't pay taxes. So you can be shot in the back of the head at the age of 16. I mean, all sorts of things can happen at 16. In fact, the matter is, we need to have a debate on whether the average 16 and 17-year-old should have the vote. And if, you know, I believe in democracy. If there's a debate, and if Parliament decides to give them the vote, I'll support that.
Okay. Now, we're running short of time. I want to go back to the audience. But first of all, the balance of the conversation has been very directed towards you, Simon, and I'm sensing a bit of Romania in the room. So, in the interest of balance, I'm asking a question for you, Christina. I was very struck a moment ago when you unpacked one of your reasons for feeling very strongly Remain. We're all about the sheer complexity of and the level of entanglement and quite how bound up we are with the European project. Now, you can even easily turn that on its head and say, that is exactly why we have to leave. Doesn't that demonstrate that the fact that it's so hard, that we have become so completely enmeshed with this supranational institution, with its remote bodies and decisions made elsewhere, doesn't that actually make the argument for leave?
No, but it was used to make the argument for leave. But no, it doesn't, because you know what? We live in a very complicated world, and we fought this trading bloc, which has worked very much in our favour. We were the fifth biggest economy in the world. I think we've now gone to the sixth. We were created. We did have the highest growth rate in the Western world. We now have the slowest. So, alas, it's not going so well a year after the EU vote. But no, I think complexity is complexity is just complexity. It wasn't just. I don't think it's just an economic argument. I mean, I'm half Swedish, I'm half Scottish, I was born in Italy, I come from an international family. I happen to believe that, you know, Europe is rather a nice place and it's quite good to be enmeshed with our neighbours, but of course it's going to be complicated to untangle that. I think you can be both pragmatic and emotional, and yes, I believe in the European project. I wasn't in favour of joining the EU. I absolutely see why some people objected to freedom of movement. I am not in favour of Romanian criminals or any other criminals coming into the country. Of course, nobody is. And of course, we ought to be able to do a better job of keeping people like that out. But, you know, there are prices to be paid, there are rules, and I think on balance, being in the EU gave us a much, much, much better deal as a country in a complex, globalised world with a digital economy where everything is changing so fast, and I think we are absolutely nuts to be untangling ourselves from that now.
Okay, so save that thought for your final words, because right, let's get right. Two very, very brief interjections. You've been waiting very patiently, sir, and yes, and then just if it's one sentence, what do you get this gentleman here, because he's more accessible. I feel like I've slightly been favoured this side, and I was hoping to get some gender balance, but the ladies didn't put their hands up that time. Shoot.
As an LSE University professor, I was appalled by the lies and scares made by the Remain campaign during the referendum, saying that people like me who voted Leave wanted to get rid of all these doctors and nurses and academics and researchers and everybody else, and after the referendum, somehow or other, Liverpool be told to leave and go back across the channel. There was never any truth in this. The trouble is the Great Scare actually worked, and they frightened themselves, and they frightened all these poor people in Europe and these poor people in the health service and in academia. So if there is a scare going on, it's because of the Remain camp. Oh, yeah. They lied through their teeth and people believe their lies.
And this gentleman here.
Thank you. Simon's description of this golden age of the 1940s and 50s was driven as much by municipal power and influence as by
national
power.
I was talking about culture, not politics.
Well, I think generally it was a time of renewal in terms of welfare state and so on.
Yeah.
And the last 30 years have really witnessed a massive centralisation of power, not from Whitehall to the European Union, but from local authorities and municipalities to Whitehall. And it's part of the solution now around reclaiming local sovereignty so that what happens within this square mile becomes much less relevant to people's lives.
Okay, thank you. So wrap your responses into that into any final thoughts. So Christina, why don't you take the project fair, and then Simon, you can talk about municipality and localism.
On the project fair point, I have absolutely no idea what you're talking about. The project fair, as far as I understand it, was terror, horror stories about what would happen to the economy, which didn't instantly happen to the economy. However, Project Fear seems to be becoming Project Reality quite quickly. But I certainly didn't hear anyone saying that people would be instantly thrown out of the UK the moment we voted to leave the EU. I don't know anyone who has heard that, so I don't really have much to say to that, except I've not heard about it. In terms of the municipal and local thing, I absolutely agree with you. I think that one of the reasons that places like Bootle feel, well, I mean, everybody outside London, a lot of places outside London do feel like another country. And there are high streets dying, and a lot of places, there are very high levels of deprivation, and people feel they don't have much power. I absolutely understand why people voted to get back more power. It's just that that wasn't the question. And I do think that, yes, I think that localism is a very good thing. I think the more people have a say in what happens to them, help design the services that will play a part of their life, the better.
Okay, Simon.
Well, Christine and I agree on localism. I'm entirely in favour of democracy, as I've repeatedly said here. And if democracy can be devolved down to parish council level, then tremendous. And I agree with you that there are people sitting over the road there who probably don't have a particularly good connection with the village in which I live or the part of London in which many of you live. And I would much rather that many decisions are taken more locally. And I think if that were to happen, you'd encourage a better caliber of person to go into local politics, which you don't always have at the moment. On the question of Project Fear and what was said and what wasn't said, there was an assertion that Christina made in her remarks a moment ago about how we've done very well out of the EU. We have and I looked this up this morning on Google, so Ben Bennett is wrong, we have a £69 billion annual trade deficit with the European Union. So they're doing frightfully well out of it, we're doing slightly less well. And Christina said a moment ago that there was great economic trouble coming. The stock market is 1,200 points higher than it was the day before the referendum. It's almost 7,400, it closed tonight. The day before the referendum, it was just under 6,200. Well, hang on a minute, that's the point. Some of us during the campaign wrote that there would be an inevitable devaluation of sterling because of the panic that would come from a no vote, and that this would make Britain the bargain basement for investment, which it has become. And you don't have to be a fat capital share portfolio to do this. Anyone in this room who's got a pension fund, you're about 15% better off than you were at the end of June last year. So I'm grateful for that. I mean, you must feel free to be grateful or ungrateful. But we are all at the moment better off because of this.
Not if we buy things in shops.
I'm not talking about going shopping. I'm talking about our long-term futures and our pension funds. What's a pension? A pension is something that
many people don't have.
Most people in this room have a pension fund.
Thank you, Simon. We can easily now replay many aspects of the Brexit debate, which hopefully will happen in the bar later, ideally without throwing bread rolls or anything more solid at anyone. But we now have to renew. I prefer your microphone.
We now.
I've turned it off.
Your microphone doesn't
work. You're not a microphone doesn't feed back as much as I want. We now have to renew our panel. But before we do that, can we very quickly say thank you, actually not very quickly, say heartily and loudly. So for the next part of our discussion, I would like to welcome, in no particular order other than the one which I've written down on my piece of paper, Kieran Divan, who is Chief Executive of the British Council, Ryan Hisayo Buchanan, who is a novelist, and Justine Thompson, QC, barrister, specialist in environmental law. Their other capabilities and skills will become clear as they speak, but the format is going to be very much the same, except this time I'm just going to ask Kieran, representing the British Council, whose support for this Demos Quarterly, I should once again underline, is much appreciated and valued by everyone in the room, to say some comments related to his contribution to the pamphlet, and then just shoot along the line with responses and thoughts, and then out for questions. So, Kieran, why don't you kick us off?
Thank you. Now have I dropped?
Yeah, sorry about that.
That's what we call a mic drop.
Can I just bring us back to maybe pick up a few of the comments we had earlier? And if I go back to the origins of the British Council, we got our Royal Charter in 1940. We were set up in the 30s to counter fascist influence in Europe through engagement. The language they talked about was using the cultural resources of the UK, defined very broadly, to foster the interchange of knowledge, ideas, and discoveries. And the reason you wanted to do that was to create a basis of friendly knowledge and understanding of the people of the UK, basically so they wouldn't join the war on the other side and shoot at us. Mm-hmm. But that concept of creating dialogue and engagement is, I think, behind our reason to want to get into this conversation around what is British identity, what is UK identity. Because of course there are multiple identities. You know, we can, I think it was Martha's contribution which talked about the barriers within. You know, you can be Scottish, you can be Welsh, you can be Northern Irish, or you can be English, or you can be from a particular community, or you can be, in David Cuddard's language, you can be from anywhere or from somewhere. This idea around that one of the big dividers in the referendum was people who were comfortable anywhere voted one way, and people who were very rooted in a particular community were more likely to vote another way. So that's why we were interested in how do we do what we do and create those connections with this dynamic that's going on in the UK. But one thing we were very conscious of was, of course, other countries in Europe and around the world are going through similar dynamics. You know, look at some of the societal things which are going on in Poland or Hungary or Germany or France or Russia or Turkey or the United States, or the list could go on. So so for us, this question of identity and who are we and how do we engage with the world wasn't really around Brexit. It was around what are the things which are going on behind Brexit or behind Trump, which we need to understand if we're going to do our job well. So one of the things that we did was we held a series of conferences, one in Berlin, one in Madrid, one here in London, and we talked to people from the educational world or the creative industry world or the science and said, well, what's important about what we do and how we do it? And it was this idea of collaboration, it was this idea of integration, this idea of making sure that people and their ideas could continue to move. Because that was a lot, as we were touching on earlier, that was a lot of this post-war solution. The Edinburgh Festival was a direct consequence of our organisation and one or two others saying we need to do something which will create an environment where we can bring the world to the UK so that we can start rebuilding these connections. So if you're a political scientist in the room, you've got the realists, who say, at the end of the day, you can't trust anyone, so have a big stick. You've got the institutionalists who, will be big fans of collaboration through institutions, be it the World Bank or the EU or anywhere else. And the constructivists who say, actually, we're all a product of our experience. And on all lenses are true, but a lot of our role, I think, as British Council, is making sure that we make sure that people out there have a very good experience of the UK which will then reflect back well through the economy or through international security or whatever it may be. The other thing which is interesting, of course, is we have to make sure that our young people have the opportunity and the experience to meet other cultures out there, to carry their identity with them, as diverse as it is, and to work, I suppose, to help other people experience the identity of the UK. We can talk about it and we can write about it, but there is nothing like, meeting somebody and having that debate over a glass of sparkling wine from Sussex, and just really sharing it. So I think one of the things we have to worry about going forward is making sure that some of the mechanisms that exist through, whether it's Erasmus Plus or whatever, that those mechanisms, that idea of every young person in the UK having an international experience at some point in their education continues. And then the last bit for me is to say, is this thing about multiple identities? I'm Irish, I'm British, I'm European, I'm from Teesside, I'm all of those at the same time. I'm a chemical engineer, so I don't know what I'm doing in this building. But I think we need to say, how do we create conversations which reflect the complexity which is Britain? And so I had just before I came out, I had a meeting with one of the religious advisors at the MOD, who's an imam. And he was saying that he had convened a meeting of imams who are chaplains in military forces around the world. And he said, just that thing of bringing people together and saying, I'm British, I'm a soldier, and I'm a proud Muslim, opened up a whole new debate. So one of the challenges for us as we go through this around saying what is UK identity is to capture all the points of view and carry all those points of view with us around the world.
Okay, thank you. Rowan, we all think we're good. Rowan's got a mic. The image that really struck me in your piece was, there's a fantastic, I would strongly recommend it, this, you talk a lot about conkers, horse chestnuts, and quite how bound up they are with a certain idea of Britishness or childhood, but also the fact that they exist, that particular flora exists in other countries and cultures, and you pose this fantastic question, which is, does the fact that they will have resonance and exist elsewhere, what is the intrinsic sort of Britishness of the conquer that we experience that's different from the conquer anywhere else? It's all one conquer. And the reason I thought it was fantastically well executed, and what I wanted to ask you in that context is, following on from this point about the distinction between people who are rooted somewhere or people who feel as if they are citizens of the world or have multiple identities, first of all, is that a distinction that you recognise? And did you get an answer? Did you satisfy yourself on the question, on the conquer question?
Okay, so I'm a novelist, and one of the things that someone decided should be in my bio is that this is Rowan Isaiah Buchanan. She's Japanese, Chinese, British, American, and people laugh when they read that aloud at readings. And I get asked, so what order does it go? Which is most important to you? And I was sort of shocked or surprised. And my novel actually came out last year, so I was having these conversations while Brexit was going on. And the thing that struck me is the way that everyone has been talking about race has changed. I remember a few years ago, I would have these conversations with these very, very nice people who would say, oh, but we fixed it, we've solved it. And then after Brexit, we've had this coming up of violence, of things that, are not wonderful. I know people who are British citizens who will be allowed to live in this country post-Brexit, but who are scared and upset by the violence that has occurred, who come from immigrant families and feel like they're being told that Britishness means a certain Yorkshire pudding version of Britishness. And Yorkshire puddings are great, but that's probably not the only way to be British. And so what I felt was very important when Demos asked me to write this essay was to look at that word, British, and ask, what does it mean to us? And for me, it means memories of a tree. But it probably means something very different for you and for all the people around the country. What we heard from, when the sort of liberal elite were shocked by the people coming from the corners of the world saying, we're unhappy, we feel threatened. it was a shock, it was a surprise. Why weren't we having those conversations? But equally, of the thousands and thousands and thousands of books that were published in 2016, and this includes cookery books, okay, this includes literature, under 100 were from people of non-white backgrounds. So that means that the stories we're being told about people who aren't white and British are mostly not coming from those people. And I think in 2011, the census said that 20%, one in five people, identified as being something other than white and British. So why aren't we getting those stories, both for people who identify that way, but for those people who are confused and frightened by immigration and don't know who these people are and feel very threatened and scared? I'm very glad to be invited here. I'm glad the demos exist, but I think we need to keep having these conversations and keep asking ourselves, okay, yes, it's easy to say, oh, I love Britain, but why do you love Britain? What is the good thing for you? Because it will be different for me. And then how can we work together to create a country that can contain all of those things?
Okay, thank you. Justin, I can see you've got some notes there, so I'm not even going to ask you a silly question. I'm just going to let you go.
Okay. So my article was called An Environmentally Ambitious Brexit, and I wrote it with a co-author, Professor McCrory. And basic Brexit has the potential for a really radical change for environmental protection in this country, because 80% of our laws, domestic environmental laws, are from the EU. And in the past, we have been world-leading this country in environmental protection. Although I have to say, it's slightly embarrassing, but Cool Britannia for environmental lawyers was exporting integrated pollution control to the rest of Europe in the late 1990s. But in 2008, this country became the first country in the world to introduce legally binding climate change targets. So we've done it in the past, and it seems to me that if Brexit is coming, we should use Brexit to become world-leading again in environmental protection. And so the article we've written explores how we can do that. And we've come up with a couple of ideas. One, making individual responsibility for the environment at the heart of environmental protection law in this country. They tried it in Germany in the late 1990s, it didn't work. The Netherlands have just introduced it in 2016. And the other way is to have statements of very clear, simple, but quite core environmental principles, like the polluter pays. You should proceed cautiously in the absence of clear scientific evidence about what activities are going to do to the environment. And there's a clarity and a symbolism and a power, I think, in the clear nature of those principles, because law is inaccessible to lots of people. It's quite technical, it's quite specialist, it's pretty dull. And I think there is something symbolic and powerful about having clarity and some powerful principles around individual responsibility and some core principles. So that was the thinking in our article.
Thank you. Before we take some questions, I want to ask a question to everyone on the panel here, and it's like inspired slightly by the gentleman's comment here who supported Leave, and I thought made a very interesting point about the fact that the fear and anxiety about culturally what Brexit Britain might be has come as much from Remainer anxiety as from the hearts of the people who want to leave the European Union. And so it's possible, isn't it, that it's a false choice that we've set up, which is but very prevalent in sort of Remainer company, which is where I spend a lot of my time being a Guardian columnist, where there is a sort of angry, resentful, defensive, insular Brexit culture, which sort of fears globalisation and wants to say stop the world and want to get off. And then there is a sort of now feeling very beleaguered, metropolitan, liberal, disoriented, confused Remainer culture. And I don't think we're certainly not going to be very healthy for the country if we proceed on that basis. So we have to find some reconciliation between these two concepts. And so just going down the panel, how optimistic are you, or what is your sense of how settled the Brexit, culturally the Brexit proposition is? How up for grabs is this, and can we actually get a synthesis of those two things so you can create an idea of Brexit Britain that isn't the negative caricature that I just outlined, and that I sense informs a lot of people in this room's judgment about what Brexit is?
And there's a wonderful organisation called Undivided, which is run by a group of young people from both sides of the debate, and that's exactly what they're exploring. And what they're trying to do is work through, okay, what are we actually trying to achieve here? And it's around saying that picking up on Simon's point that not being a member of the EU doesn't mean that the UK is not in Europe. You know, we're not floating off into the middle of the Atlantic. That we do have to engage not only with the 27 member states you know, when we leave, but we have to engage with the rest of the world as well. So I think the bit I hope is settled is people saying that the intent of Britain not being Little Britain sitting on its island is settled. But I think we have to fight for that. It won't happen if we don't put the effort in. So I think there's kind of an intent, would be my view. But I would be looking at data from people like Undivided on that.
Rowan, what makes you, how can you be, how optimistic can you be for us about this?
Well, when Brexit came through, I was visiting friends in America who didn't really know what it was until it was happening. And they came to me and they said, Rowan, explain Brexit to us, which is a bit difficult, especially on the day. And the thing they were reacting to is they had a story in their minds about Britain. And that story sort of had Cool Britannia and Downton Abbey, and it was a bit of a mess, but they really liked it. It seemed great. And then suddenly there was this story about uncertainty, about fear, about anger, about sort of divides in the nation, and they were scared. And I'm not saying the newspaper shouldn't have reported that bad things were happening. Of course they should, mostly what they do. But that became the news story. And everyone kept going, oh, is Britain racist? Is that the news story about Britain? And I really hope that isn't the news story about Britain. So I think at some point we'll have to stop saying, having the conversation about, oh, is Brexit the right thing to do? Because it will have happened. And we'll have to come up with a news story about Britain. And I think that that doesn't mean lying to ourselves about our flaws. You were mentioning talking about the warts as well. But I think it does involve coming up with our aspirations for this country. That's one of the things I really loved about Justine's essay, was it was very hopeful. It wasn't saying we're the best currently as we could be in environment and we're better than everyone else. It was going, we have this opportunity to become leaders in this way. And I hope that that's the sort of story that we can send out now.
Give us some of that optimism.
Well, I think the key thing is the environment has no boundaries. Climate change, air pollution, it's not going to stop at Britain because we're no longer part of Europe. So there are some extraordinarily powerful European principles. For example, every country in Europe has a duty and a responsibility to protect the species and the habitats that are rare around Europe. And if they happen to be in your country, you protect them. Now, there's some powerful statements there that we can still sign up to as a matter of our domestic sovereignty, but we can also chip away at the bits that haven't worked quite so well, of which, you know, everybody will have a list. So I think also we're seeing on the ground forums of European forums of judges. There's still a desire among the British judiciary to be part of European judicial forums, to look at common environmental solutions and legislative solutions and judicial solutions. So there's a sort of will on the ground that we should tap into and accept that it's coming from domestic sovereignty now, but we shouldn't lose our own environmental ambition, and nor need we.
Okay, let's get some thoughts, contributions, questions from the floor. I'm looking at this side of the room because these guys are really on it, and you guys are really not putting your weight question-wise. Now I see, oh, it's this lady, excellent, good work, right down there. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you very much for that, Paul, to all the panellists. I think I was feeling a little bit depressed after the first panel, partly because it epitomised so well the state of public debate and negativity and kind of polarisation at the moment. And something that all three of you kind of spoke about was the hopefulness and optimism about the future. And if anything, Cool Britannia was that sort of optimistic debate. So my question is, looking forward, what sort of leadership do we need at a national level, both cultural and political, to make more of that optimistic debate happen and achieve kind of salience for everyone?
Great, thank you. And that was just this gentleman there.
Thank you, and also thank you to the panel. Picking up something that Rowan, you said. You said that, you know, people were asking you, is Britain racist now? I'm interested in that. You know, what does the whole panel think that Brexit means people will think about us. Are we racist and insular, or are we taking a great step towards sovereignty? Is that what people think of us, and will that affect our culture in the future and how people write about Britain?
Okay, let's go back to the panel. I can't see any frantic waggling of hands there, so let's start with Justine this time.
I'm going to ask the question, what do we need from our leaders? I think I've already said it really, we need environmental ambition. And there have been enough statements from governments of all colours, British governments from all colours over the last 25 years, about leaving the environment a better place than we found it. The concept of we're stewards, we're only on the environment for a few short years. The environment will be around for much longer than we ever will be. So we have a stewardship responsibility. All that you find in government white papers from over the years. So as long as there is domestic ambition, I think there is a degree of optimism. And I think there's an interesting dynamic in that the judiciary, there's some evidence, they've been pretty cautious about European Union principles. It's a kind of cultural thing that we've had. We're a bit sceptical about some things from Europe. And so the judiciary have been too. There's some small evidence on the other side that when environmental protection concepts are homegrown, there's a new concept of no net loss of biodiversity, which is being applied in development projects. When concepts are truly homegrown, people seem to imbue them more deeply, possibly, certainly some of the judiciary have. So that evidence, combined with environmental ambition from whoever are our leaders over the next 20 or 30 years, gives some cause for optimism.
Right, before we answer that, Justine, I'm just going to pick you up on something there. You're being very diplomatic, which I admire, but is it not also the case that a lot of the drive and the ambition for Brexit initially came from a political ideology of a right of British politics that is not only sceptical about the idea of environmental regulation, but actually sceptical about the very concept of climate change? You also have about to land in Parliament in September the European Union withdrawal bill, which will create what we call Henry VIII powers, essentially giving ministers and essentially behind them officials an extraordinary breadth of power to strike bits of European law off the statute, but with almost no scrutiny at all. We can say with a degree of confidence that there will be people who are very interested in using those powers very specifically to weaken the regime of environmental protection and regulation in this country, and to do exactly the opposite of the thing that you're describing. So although your optimism is welcome, maybe you could just explain in a little bit more detail why you don't think that's a problem.
Look, I was told to be optimistic. I'm doing my brief like any good lawyer does. I think everything you said I can see, and Brexit's got the real potential for disaster for the environment, that gives up 80%, but if Brexit is coming, let's make the best of it. And I did say environmental ambition from our politicians is absolutely key. So that's what I'd say to that. But look at air pollution. Air pollution has gained a political traction, and there is a real strong sense growing in this country of air pollution is a national public emergency. And the courts are picking up on that, and they're being influenced by it. So the recent Client Earth litigation against the government about the air pollution plans, the judges were saying things like, we will not delay this air pollution plan during the general election period, because 64 people die every day in this country while governments faff around bringing out air pollution plans. So, the courts will respond, and there are mechanisms in the law still available to them to respond. Now, the courts don't want to be, and the judges don't want to become, the only bulwark against untrammeled power from ministers, because one of the key features of environmental law has been the European Commission and this supranational enforcement body who've been able effectively to hold governments to account, and the courts don't want to have to take up that political football for obvious reasons. So, there is a real risk there, I think.
I'll respond to as much as all of that. That's fine.
Okay, so I'm a novelist, not a politician, and so this may come across as naive, but I think we're at a real risk of being people standing in front of a burning building or pointing at each other and going, you set the fire. And I sort of wonder what of that house we can say, what, if we are in chaos now, which people on both sides have told me, then what is it that we can say, but what do we want to build? And I would really like that for my politicians. I'm sure I won't agree with all of their visions for what they want to build, but I want to start hearing that rather than, oh, it's all your fault over there. That's my wish. And I think that if we start telling that to each ourselves, if we start working that, then that will come out internationally, that people will see us as a country with a vision. I'm not going to choose it for everyone else, because I actually, you know, do believe in democracy, as some other people here do, although I may have very different opinions about what the results should be.
Thank you. Kieran, but, you've also been very diplomatic. And so I'm going to also ask you to just focus in a little bit. I'd like you to look this gentleman who asked the question in the eye, and I'd like you to tell him that you're not at all worried in any way that Brexit has damaged Britain's brand overseas in the last year.
In the eye.
It has damaged the brand in particular places. And we did a survey before the referendum of 20,000 young people across the G20, and we surveyed 20,000 young people across the G20 after the referendum to see what the difference was, because you know, we just wanted to understand how big or smaller the problem was and if there was one. The summary version is, outside the EU members of the G20, people kind of didn't notice. They said, well, you know, there are other things going on in my part of the world, and I've heard about it, and I don't think it'll make much difference, and you know, if you were from one particular country, you say, oh, great, cheap travel destination, one or two other countries said maybe a bit less cool, or whatever. The problem was within the EU members. What those young people said was, overall, we still like the UK, you know, it hasn't gone down the rankings. But we worry a bit about these stories of xenophobia. We worry about the stability and the common sense of the politics. But we still like the institutions. We think the universities are marvellous. We love the BBC, the rule of law, etc. So it was a differentiated response. So at least now we know where we have to go and do our work. But young people in the UK and in Germany, France and Italy is the other members, if they represent the EU member states, we have a lot of work to do.
And the question about leadership?
Leadership, I think, engage leadership. But I would maybe say it's not only the politicians, it's people like me who work for an organisation. And I loved the comment earlier about, if you do one thing, get involved in local politics and fix the potholes and for yourself and everyone else. And whether it's running organisations, I think so. This engaged thing is maybe the most important thing we should expect from all our leaders, and define that leadership very broadly.
Okay. Any more questions, comments, observations? Oh, yes. Oh, we've got a couple of hands there. Oh, yes. So certainly your microphone. Yeah. So we're going to walk straight up to this gentleman here, and then veer after him, veer left to that hand there. I can't tell the gender of the hand.
Hi, my name is Sagar. In terms of environmental issues, and I've done quite a lot of research, issues to do with the oceans, issues to do with pollution, issues to do with water rats in the southern hemisphere, which somehow sort of bypasses us in the northern hemisphere, because it's been going on in the south for 10, 15, 20 years, especially Australia and India. My question with regards to the oceans, which is something which is always very much out of sight, out of mind, is when we're talking about climate change, I think most people are aware that a third of the oceans are covered in plastic. But there's not really much in mainstream media, if nothing at all, about the fact that the other third is covered in pollution from Fukushima, which is stretched all the way to the Gold Coast, Australia. And then that remains only a third left, which is where the fish or the sea life can actually reside. And for the sea life to survive and sustain itself, the key issue that most people forget is the algae and the blooms, which are withering away very fast. So whatever the issues of Brexit are, this is something that's been going for a long time. But is it possible that we could have more of a focus on that and actually look at what's going on in the places that we actually very much overlook?
Thank you. Yes.
I'm from
from that former penal colony called Australia, where you exported many people to. And I have to say, I didn't feel very welcome when I came in and spent an hour and a half in Heathrow the other day. As an Australian, I don't feel welcome. But I would like to say that Australia has struggled with multiculturalism because we're no longer white Anglo-Saxon, even though my father's English. But how does multiculturalism figure in the identity of Britain today?
Okay. There was some quite intense marine biology there, but I think we can all agree that is an issue that probably deserves, or almost certainly deserves, a lot more attention. I don't know, Kieran, if you want to start, you can engage the marine biology, but I would understand if you chose not to get too into the detail of that.
I'm probably the least qualified person, but support the premise. Multiculturalism, I think it's very much part of the story of modern Britain. And as we tell whatever this new story that develops over time, you know, there are a number of things which are common. You know, there's the, you know, and I speak as an immigrant, I suppose, and there's the generosity of Britain, which, you know, if you come from another country and you see development assistance, or you see the willingness to engage in modern slavery, or whatever it is. And another part of the story is that we have lots of stories, and we always have had the, you know, there's the Irish community, obviously, you know, and then the more recent communities, you know, the Somali community that's moved to South London. So I think we have that story to tell, but again, we tell it as it really is. We tell it as some things are going well and some things are not. You know, there are things we get right and there are things we don't get right. So I think we do tell that story, but from a very positive point of view. Back to my imam I was talking to this afternoon, he was saying that when he travels the world, that the biggest thing he has to do is quash some of the stories that go around. You know, you're not allowed to build a mosque with a minaret in the UK. Well, that's just not true. You know, let me show you a photograph of the mosque I go to. And that there is an awful lot we have done well here that we have to recognise, and sharing that with other countries is part of our story. Now, we're not right, we're not perfect, you know, we've a long way to go in everything, including the environment. But, you know, I think we need to capture what we have done well. And one of the examples I talk a lot, which is probably easy for me to talk about, is the story of Northern Ireland. You know, where we've gone from a position where, you know, as somebody from Dublin, I just wouldn't go north, you know, because I wouldn't know how each community would react to me. On my phone, I've got a photograph of me, a DUP Lord Mayor of Belfast, a 24-year-old Sinn Féin minister from Newry, and a 30-year-old DUP minister from Ballymena. That combination of people could not have appeared in a photograph 20 years ago, or when I was, you know, 24 years old. It's, you know, we've made a lot of progress, but we worked at it. You know, we put in 40 years of effort in Northern Ireland, and there are things like that we can learn, and things like that we can carry around the world with us as well.
On this multiculturalism point, I think it's very interesting because this word is used in different ways by different people. In some sense, there's a very kind of a culture, loose cultural idea that isn't it wonderful that we have many different cultures represented. Country of London in particular is seen as this emblematic global capital, sort of festival of successful integration and multiculturalism. And then it's also used pejoratively as a policy, as if it were a policy doctrine. And in some cases it has been an active decision as well to promote and prioritise certain ways of expressing culture at the expense of an, in quotes, indigenous culture. And that people can then use the word sort of polyvalently, deciding whether there's something they think is a good idea, which they refer to the nice soft cultural thing, or negatively if they want to not like it. So how do you understand this word?
Okay, well, my understanding of it is growing and changing, and I actually want to talk about part of that. So recently, I've been spending a lot of my time in Norwich, and Norfolk is one of the whitest parts of Britain, just statistically. But there's a building called Strangers Hall in Norfolk, And I was very curious about it because it's a great name. And so I sort of started reading about it. And basically what happened is there was this huge immigration from the lowland Protestants during, I think it was the 15th or 16th century, coming up because they were fleeing the Catholics. You know, there's a lot of fighting about it. And we let them into Britain. And there was outrage in Norfolk. But these people had textile skills. And that was worth money. And that was exciting. And that, you know, that became part of Norfolk. It became, you know, part of the town, in part of Norwich. And, you know, it seems silly now, sort of like one of those antiquated history lessons of like, oh, there was this time when we were really worried they would come and eat our babies, but wasn't that silly? And, you know, it wasn't silly to them. At the time, it was frightening. They had the exact same things of these people will come and steal our jobs. Like, that was a problem. They were scared. And now, Norfolk wouldn't be Norfolk without them. It couldn't, you know, we'd have an entirely different world. So I think one of the things that we can do with multiculturalism, whether, you know, I might be a bit biased, I think it's a good thing, whether you like it or don't like it, is to sort of put it as a separate thing. You just sort of, it's like an extra colour you can put on, and it's not really essential, but actually, you can't have Britain without multiculturalism. You can't have this nation the way it is. And so the idea that it's somehow this separate, other extracurricular thing makes no sense to me.
Do you want to pass the mic through? And I'm slightly relying on you, Justine, to also get us through taking back control of our water.
Yeah, I am ready for that question. I can even bring some optimism on marine pollution. And the reason, I mean, I genuinely mean this, joking aside, international environmental law protects the oceans through a very powerful concept called, it's a common resource or a common heritage of mankind, and therefore every country in the world has a responsibility to protect the oceans. International environmental law is still available to us. Look, it's got its limitations and its difficulties, but it was interesting that Kieran just said the rule of law in Britain is recognised around the world. So is the quality of our legal services. Lawyers are being forced into a creativity that we haven't had to deal with or access before. We're driven to that by Brexit and these significant changes, but that's a journey, and that's exciting, it's interesting, and who knows what might come from it. Some really radical potential for change.
Any thoughts on multiculturalism? You don't have to.
The judiciary could do with a lot more multicultural judges.
Okay. Right, we're very short on time, so a bit of final thoughts, then we'll come back to our panel for their closing remarks. Right, so, yes, I'm reading out Kieran printing answers already, your wife, yeah, I'm too, go Dars, mine too jersey. So this gentleman here, and then, this side of the room, well, we're not, no one's going anywhere until there's another person from this side of the room, but you shoot in the meantime.
Okay, thank you. Just simply, I wonder if the panel thinks that Brexit is actually a very healthy thing for our democracy. People are engaging. You know, more people are voting, more people care. Politics was very bland, now it's interesting.
We live in interesting times. Right, you're on this side. I can be here. I've got marking to do. I can be here all day. Right, you're on this gentleman. Well, you've already had a go, but go on.
It's a different panel. If somebody were to stab you outside there, you might have an epiphany. You might suddenly realise what to do about everything with absolute clarity. But the stabbing might disable your ability to do that stuff. You might be either dead or suffer what people now call life-changing injuries. And if there aren't, you know, finding reasons to be cheerful, I think about this, is the British disinclination to think things through. And one of the things you find in this government is a disinclination to think things through in terms of the economics, which nobody really has mentioned, in terms of the economics. And we know they're disinclined to think it through because they don't talk about it.
Okay.
Because they haven't got anything to talk about. And I think multiculturalism is one of those things. There are people haven't thought it through.
Okay, thank you very much. We're going to very quickly go on the panel. I'm really sorry, we don't have any more time for questions. So I want to start with you, Justine. The upside and metaphorical stabbing, and then in the closing remarks, you don't need to actually, you don't need to act at that moment.
I don't really have anything further to say. I've exhausted my levels of optimism.
Help us out here, Robert, with some optimism. Think conquers, channel conquers.
Well, if I'd been stabbed, I could lie there thinking I'm going to die, and I might then die, or I could sit there thinking, oh, I'm going to have a nice tea, and then I'll still die, but I would rather spend my last minutes at least trying to plan for a future, because if I'm really just doomed, there's not much point, is there?
Relying on you here to some triage, serious psychic triage.
I'm trying to surpass that. But I think, you know, in terms of British identity, UK identity, we need to have more of this debate, because I think it is when we talk across the way that we define ourselves that we actually work out what Britain really is. And I think we've done it before, and we need to do it again. And then if you're in my job, you need to carry that conversation around the world.
Admirable application of hand pressure on open wounds there. I'm really impressed by that. Obviously, on the first aid course. Right, we're out of time. So I'd just like to say thank you, Kieran Devan, Rowan Hisai Buchanan, Justine Thornton. Thank you, audience, for your brilliant contributions and questions, and for it's been a very hot room, and so you've been really patient and attentive, for which I, as the chair, am very grateful. Thank you very much.